paid last history time. Take out your history books and turn to page 111.
Oh man, history stinks.
You sound just like your mother. The way it was.
The history of Montague Elementary School.
Hello, my name is Susie, and these are my video friends. We're all students at Montague Elementary School in Montague, California. Now, Montague is a small community with one elementary school. The neat thing about our community and school is that there are many adults still living here that went to our school when they were little kids. Let's meet some of them. Come on!
Back in time.
Hi, my name is Heather, and we were here with Yreka and her daughter, Carolyn Houghton. Yreka, when did you come to this?
My father was born over in Hobie, Hobie Gulch in 1910. He moved into the house that Mrs. Houghton lives in right now. I was born there, and I was raised there. This is all this road was dirt road when I grew up. In 1910, my dad went to the school, Shasta River School, and in 1932, I went to this school, and this is where I got starting at my first and second and third grade. And as we came in here, there was always a bridge right across this school. What happened to me was I got real excited and wanted to beat everybody across the bridge.
Ooh. But you are
71, so it's been here a long time. They had up on the hill here, as we look this way, there was a place for the horses whenever they rode in. And then next to there was outdoor privy. There was a pile of wood here. The school was heated by wood. We always had wood. And one day when we came in, we used to ride with my cousin, who lived next door in a 1929 Chevrolet with open sides. And we rode part of the time, we walked part of the time, the 4 miles from my home. And then as we came across the bridge, I was trying to be first, and I fell off the bridge into the mud and into the weeds. And the teacher always wore a big apron. And she took that big apron off, and we went in back in the out there in the privy. I took my dress and slip off and my socks. She put them on the woodpile and put the apron around me, and I stayed behind the organ inside the building until it was dry so that I could put them back on. This building was, it had two floors. The floor where all the where we wrote and where we studied, and then we stepped up one, and there was an organ in one corner and a dunce stool. You know what a dunce stool is? One who acts up and tries to be funny in school, and they always had to sit before all the students. The boys and the girls all learned how to sew. Every Friday we had memorization, in which we had to have a little poem. And when we went on the swings, if you switch over here, these swings, all the little kids, I went the first, second, and third grade here. And we used to go round and around on these swings. And the older boys used to catch our feet, and you can imagine, hit that. And we got so that whenever the bigger boys were around, we never did go around. But it's been here ever since then. And it's been here since 1871. And it's still pretty solid.
Okay, when's your birthday?
Pretty soon. And I was born in 1926.
Okay. Did you have a most embarrassing moment at Montague Elementary School?
At the Montague Elementary School?
Anyways.
The Montague Elementary School, I went from this school, my cousin and my twin sister and I, there was only three of us for the last 2 years the school was going. And when they closed the school down, we went the other way out there at the Four Corners, and we went with a Mrs. Prather, who was teacher out at Snowden. And we went there for 3 years until the seventh grade, and then we went to Montague, seventh and eighth grade. Building there was the second one. The first one was a two-story brick building in which my father went there. So he went to the first school in Montague. I went to the second one, and Carolyn went to third and fourth, and she was on Main Street. That's where she went to her first grade. And my youngest daughter went to the fourth school, and my granddaughters went to the fourth school, in which you children are going to school right now.
So then what happened to the school?
Well, after we closed the Snowden School, again, there was only three of us, so we, my mother and my dad took us to Montague School. The first Montague School there was built in 1890. It was a brick building, two-story, and the new school was made, let's see, they had four rooms and 55 pupils. The teacher was paid $75 a month to teach the children. And of course, they replaced it with the new school, which is there now, where we now have City Hall, and we have the swimming pool, and such as that. We had a water fountain. There was four rooms, storerooms, one room, portable stage, and was used as an auditorium. And we had nine grades for a year. So that meant that junior high was the first of the ninth grade that was taught in Montague. Favorite thing, a lady went out in her garden and brought me a dozen red roses from her garden. That's what I got for graduation, and I just really enjoyed it.
Wow.
Now, in 1955, the new school went into operation, but in 1954, even though she went to it, 54, she had to go to school, Mrs. Hilton, on Main Street. Maybe she can tell you a little bit on her Main Street first grade if she remembers.
I'm Vera Clement's daughter. When did you come to Montague?
I started my first grade in Montague on Main Street, which is now an electric company business. And we went to the Montague School, which is right now on the City Hall, for my second, I believe, middle of my third grade, and then went to the new school in 1955 that they had built. The school that we presently have has two wings. At that time, there were only one, first through seventh or through eighth grade, and that's where I graduated from eighth grade. We were the largest class to ever graduate. We had 32 students. It was really exciting for us to go to a new school, because having an old school like I went to in the second grade, everything creaked. I remember, like anybody else, you know, girls chase the boys chase the girls, and you're always getting in trouble for it. But I found it exciting. I always liked school. We were always raised on a ranch, and always had lots of work, and that was always a plus for us. But we loved school and tried to work hard at it.
Okay, what was your most embarrassing moment at Montague?
Oh, goodness. There probably were several. I would just probably forget.
How about the hair pulling? You knocked the boy out.
Yeah, I was sent home for half a day. I was quite strong for my age, so when a boy gave me a bad time, usually he got the worst of it. In fact, I very seldom lost.
Okay, what was your best memory?
My best memory. My best memory was probably graduating from Montague Elementary. Eighth grade was really a special year for me. A little scary thinking about going to high school, but at that time, I just really felt good about being a good student. I
was a straight-A student in grammar school. It didn't last, but that probably was one of my special moments. And I got to sing at graduation. I sang Over the Rainbow, and my mother played the Pomp and Circumstance for graduation, which was very special to me at that time.
Okay, what was your favorite sport in school?
My favorite sport in school was softball. We had a wonderful softball team, Montague. We didn't realize it until three quarters of the way through the season that we were the champions of all the elementary school. And then we really had to pour it on in order to get the trophy. And there wasn't one available, but we suckered our coach into finding a sponsor. And they had a plaque made for us with all of our names on it, because we did win every game we played that year. So.
Thank you for the interview, Vera.
Carolyn, we appreciate it, and we're glad that you could come and spend your time with us. Thanks.
We thank you.
Thank you very much. We're here today at the site of the old Montague School. With us today is Marcetta Katie Campbell and her sister Joyce Foster. The old school, the first one in the town of Montague, was built in 1889. Then in 1915, it was torn down and the bricks were used to build the school as you see now. So, Katie and Joyce, what can you tell us about that time?
Well, we have a lot we can tell you.
But not as early as 1915.
No.
I started in probably 1930.
And I started my first grade here in 1936, and I graduated in 1944 from the eighth grade here. So we can tell you in those time slots what we remember about the school. We had wonderful times in here. Just, it brings back so many wonderful memories of us. Now, Katie, you can tell about the yard.
Well, the school yard itself had a 6-foot fence all around it. And they had a fence on each side, and one in the back and one in the front. And there was a concrete sidewalk all the way to the front. And once a month we had fire drills, and all the classrooms would have to go clear out to the front gate to let us come back in. And then we, before we ever went in the classroom, we lined up here. The 6th, 7th, and 8th graders was over here on this side, on the right side, and in the center was the first and second graders, and on the left was the third, fourth, and fifth graders. And then there was a monitor that would start the old phonograph to march music, and as soon as that would start, we would all, the first and second graders would file in first, then the third, fourth, and fifth, and then the older kids, the 6th, 7th, and 8th would file in. First thing when we was in there, we saluted the flag, and then the school took off.
Okay, well, let's go in.
Now, as we marched in, the first and second grades would go to this door here.
It was right there, that room. Was that your classroom?
That was my first grade. I started the first grade there.
Yes.
By the desk. They were all lined up here. Our stove was back in that corner.
Where the stove is now?
Yes. And it was a big wood stove.
Yes.
Oh, you heated in wood.
And they had a bar around it to keep the kids from getting too close.
What were the teachers like?
Strict.
They were real strict. There was no whispering, talking, or getting up and walking from one desk to another. None of that.
When you had to use the restroom, you raised your hand and you didn't get up until she told you you could leave.
Oh, uh-huh.
And the classroom was just as quiet unless she was working with one of the other grades and they were having reading or questions aloud or something. Otherwise, it was very quiet.
That was the 6th, 7th, and 8th grade room. The ones that sat clear back here, oh, in the wintertime your feet got so cold because we had all the stayed up in front or up high, I don't know. We didn't have the copying machines in those days. We had what was called a hectograph. It was just a deal like this with kind of a jelly-like stuff on it.
Yeah, it was a flat pan and had a jelly surface. And when they put the paper that had the printing on it, you would put that on, and then they'd pull that off, and then we took the white pieces of paper and put that on there, pressed it, and peeled it off, and it came off on the paper.
We had our own little 6th, 7th, and 8th grade newspaper. We'd done it on the hectograph and things like that. Boy, the copying machine would have really been wonderful, wouldn't it?
Yes.
How many students did you have? Do you know about?
I don't remember the grammar school. I do remember my 8th grade year how many we had. We had 36 in there, and that was 15 8th graders, 12 7th graders, and there was only 11 6th graders, because I have that down on my little school graduation program.
Okay. And our teacher, and my teacher, and probably her teacher too, was Mrs. Lancelot.
Oh, she
was here for years and years and years, and I think she taught all of the kids in school when I went.
Yeah.
She
and
was
I can't even remember. I think she was still here when I graduated from grammar school.
What year did you graduate, Joyce?
From 1944.
I graduated in 1939.
39?
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Who would your guys' best friends have to be during school?
Oh, who was your best friend? You started out, I remember.
My best friend was Patsy Quigley.
And I had two best friends. We started in the 1st grade and finished the 8th together, Evelyn Tyler and Alta Pope.
Do any of them still live around here?
Evelyn does. She lives in Yreka, and we see each other, not regularly, but, you know, sometimes. And we always send our cards and notes with it back and forth for holidays and stuff.
Now, I lost track of my best friend. The last I heard, she was a dealer in Reno dealing blackjack or something. And, so that's the last I heard of her.
Who is your guys' principal?
Principal?
When I went to school, it was Mrs. Prather. We had different ones. One year it was, we had a man principal one year called Mr. Brownie.
Yes, and whoever taught.
Mr. Pedler was one, and Mrs. Childers, and then when I graduated from the 8th grade, it was Mrs. Rita Prather.
Now, who the teacher for the 6th, 7th, and 8th grade teacher class was also the principal.
Oh.
They were also the principal of the school.
What was your guys' most embarrassing moment?
Oh, my.
I can't remember.
I remember mine. Just come to me. I slipped and fell down in that mud hole that used to be out off the back steps. As I was going home, we lived right across there, and I was going home for lunch, right across the street, and there was a big mud hole right out here by the back step, and I slipped as I come down the back step and landed right with my behind in that mud puddle, and I had to go home and get cleaned up and everything, eat, and then rush back.
I'm sure I had one, but I can't remember right now what it would be, unless it was when we were playing baseball, and the boys and girls have their teams, you know, together. And this boy got up and hit one, and I was in between first and second base playing the field. And when his ball came to me, it was really fast and furious, and I bent down to pick it up, to get it, and it hit my dress, and I caught the ball, and oh, that boy was mad because I caught that ball with my dress.
And we could not wear pants. Girls were not allowed to wear pants at all. And one time a friend of mine, her mother had made her a lovely pantsuit, and she came to school in that, and the teacher, the principal, made her go home until she changed it back.
Ooh.
Yeah, they were very strict.
Now, let's go to this room here.
We practiced our plays up here on the stage, and used to be a trap door there off to the side, and the students waiting to come on, for their turn to come on during the program we were having, some of the students would open the trap door and go down in underneath in a tunnel kind of thing, that would come out into the basement. And one time my brother and another boy come out when it was their turn, and they had cobwebs all over them. They'd been down in the basement. One of our rooms had a great big picture of Washington and of Lincoln, and of whoever the president was that was in office at the time, his was up there too. And no matter what party our folks belonged to, be it Republican or Democrat, whoever was elected president, boy, we was proud of him. We just studied about his families. It's so different than what it is now. We were so proud of our president.
Very bad vandalism when you were at the school?
Very little. Very little. Once in a while, maybe a basketball or something, or football or baseball would be left out on the playground, and the next morning it would be gone. But
you know, it usually always came back.
Yeah, somebody eventually would bring it back.
Yeah, there was very little.
And I remember at Halloween time, some kids would take the neighbor lady's goats and tie them to the rope on the bell, and the bell would, every time the goat had jumped, the bell would ring, and everybody on this end of town got blasted out of bed with that bell ringing.
Yes. I can remember my mother and dad saying, we didn't sleep a wink last night, that darn school bell rang all night long.
And that's just the prank the kids like to play, just come along and pull that old rope and get the bell going.
But they didn't do any vandalism at school at all. They just did little things around town, like the outhouses. They would push those over, and they'd do little things.
Did you have outhouses at the school?
No.
We had our restrooms. But some of the homes still had the old outhouses, and those were the ones that would get pushed over.
This is where that tall pole was, with the four chains on it, and that we'd either swing around, or we'd put our legs through one of the bars and just go. Oh, we could go way, huh? The swings and the rings and then the bars would walk to the north.
Yeah, we clung on those, or we hung by our knees or whatever on those. They were just stationary bars, and we had fun on those too, climbing on them and playing on them. And the boys would get on them, and they would straddle it. And they'd hold on somehow or other, and they'd spin around. Remember?
Yeah.
Like a propeller.
Uh-huh.
Thank you for sharing your experiences with us. Welcome.
Thank you for asking us. It has really brought back a lot of memories.
We enjoyed doing this.
This is the Montague School now.
We're here today with three community members, Rex Hochin, Donna Hammond, and Goldie Pierce. They all attended Montague Elementary School in the 1960s. Thanks for joining us. So I understand this room was your kindergarten room. So I bet you have a lot of memories about your school days. What was it like at MES in the 1960s?
Go ahead.
It was fun. A lot of fun there. It's a long time ago.
Mm-hmm.
School was much smaller than I
did. I got along to it a lot. Mm-hmm. I think our classroom, there was more kids in every room now.
Seemed like a lot.
We started here in kindergarten. The room seemed bigger. Tables were bigger than
it. What were the teachers like?
More strict.
Mm-hmm.
You kind of had to just, pay attention and learn.
Well, a couple years ago, some of them were still here.
That's true.
About the same thing.
How did the kids dress? I mean, could they wear jeans or girls wear pants?
You could wear whatever you wanted.
What was your best memory?
Well, here at kindergarten, I don't know. What was, I guess, just getting to come to town and see other kids. That playing with all the toys they had. Remember rocking boat? He used to leave over there in that corner. Whenever we were good, we could play on it. you grab a hold of it and mash your fingers. It's like a punishment toy.
Donna's got her smashed really bad.
Yeah, my fingers went black and fell off. I only tripped to the office.
What grade level we went to the field trip out to your house?
Second, I think.
Is that where I went? Remember there was a bird nest in, at the gate or something?
Mm-hmm.
What was the most fun thing that you did at school?
Play?
Okay. Probably sports with other schools.
What kind of sports did you have at the other schools? With the other schools, what did you play?
It was a Mountain Valley League. The girls would always play volleyball. The boys played football.
We did track. We did track too.
And then basketball. And then there was not a softball because everybody played Little League then. Evergreen, the Mustangs, Mountie, Broncos. Kind of divided the class up every spring. Who was on whose team?
Intramurals.
Mm-hmm. Did you play on a team, Donna? Did you play intramural?
Mm-hmm.
What'd you play? Like volleyball or?
Yeah, I played softball and kickball.
Mm-hmm. How did Montague rate?
They were like number one in football.
In football, really? They have trophies?
Somewhere.
Somewhere, something. Somewhere, trophies.
Were you champions for like
four or five
years in a row?
Wasn't
Mr. Simmons your coach?
Mm-hmm.
You always wore that red.
Oh, that's right. I still got my little bitty most valuable player coat. Everything was small back then.
What did teachers discipline students back then?
How did they?
Yeah, how did they?
Well, Mr. Hyman was the principal, and he had a paddle. I have to say, I made 100 trips to the office and never once got the paddle. He took me home several times.
I think because it just hung up there and he knew what would happen, that he didn't really get into much trouble.
David Lovell got it all the time, though.
Who else got it? Oh, what?
Tim Miller?
Oh, yeah.
Everybody, but I never did. I'd like Higson's.
Oh,
they about wore it out.
Did you?
No, I never got it. Never got it.
This is back in the 60s, you know, before women lived. They never did.
The teachers, I think they just kind of, I don't remember getting in trouble in the classroom with the teacher. What about you, Rex? What did they do in the classroom? Do you remember?
Just normal.
Stand in the corner.
Wasn't there somewhere we had to?
It goes to
the top.
Oh. But didn't we have to stand in the corner in some? Isn't it Miss Pink kindergarten? We had to stand in the corner. Feel that? I don't know. I remember my dad gave me my 8th grade diploma. He was on the school board. But yeah, we did everything in the cafeteria. Basketball game.
In this wing, we're just this. Well, there's this normal wing. Four rooms here, and that was it.
Yeah, kindergarten, first and second. Now, the third grade was already being home.
Mm-hmm. We had a split third grade.
Oh, they had a split class?
Mm-hmm.
You had a lot of kids? Huh.
Sixth grade was split, too, wasn't it?
No, sixth we all had Cook.
Oh, that's right. The fifth grade was, because we had some of the fourth graders in Mr. Duesenberg. We had Duesenberg.
Mm-hmm.
And there's some fourth graders in there too. Yeah. And then what class was it? I had Mrs. Buck then, and you guys had someone else. Was it Mrs. Peter then?
Third
was that
grade.
Fourth?
Third?
Third. I had Mrs. Jones. She was another one that was.
What was her name?
Buckton, wasn't it? Dark haired lady?
Buckton.
What was it?
Buckton.
Yeah, what was that? No,
because the Jacksons right. Always called the Butlers.
So, what was her name?
I don't know.
Something. Dark hair.
That was about when the twins really looked alike. Sometimes we'd have Doug in the class, and sometimes we'd just switch at random.
Did the teachers ever know they were switching?
They could never tell them apart.
Oh, good grief.
They had to know when they were talking about it.
They always dressed alike, like whenever there was a party, a Christmas party, or Valentine's Day or something. Teachers would never know. It's back and forth.
Now, what year did they come? Do you remember when
they came? It was here in third grade. Steve Harney come in second.
And in kindergarten, there was Mary, Cassie, and Kathy, and us three. Oh, yeah, Corey Penn.
Kevin Shaw.
Bones. Daryl Frost, he wasn't. Was he in kindergarten?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because I have it in that kindergarten picture. Daryl Frost's picture is in here. That's right. So who was your favorite teachers?
Mr. Dusenberry.
He was yours?
Yeah, because I got on the A honor roll.
Oh.
Yeah. He was my favorite.
What grade was that?
Fifth grade.
How about you?
I have a lot. Mrs. Dieter, Mr. Dusenberry, and Mr. Simmons.
Mr. Simmons was? Really?
Now, he was.
I'd say Mr. Simmons was probably my favorite teacher.
Yeah, he's still around here. He's been doing the work on that. Something with a greenhouse.
Fish and Wildlife. Yeah.
Oh, was that? Is, oh.
I remember when my dad had the hernia surgery, and I wasn't going to come to school. Simmons and Woodruff both come out every morning and help me feed cows and brought me to school.
They spent
probably 2 weeks feeding cows before they come to school. I think that's why I had more respect for Mr. Simmons.
Did you have a lot of chores before you lived out on a ranch? Then did so you had a lot of chores before you went to school?
Milk three cows. I brought when I'd go to the bus, I'd have to drive the bus, and I'd bring my 4 gallons of milk and usually 3 or 4 dozen eggs to school with me every morning. And then they'd wash the bottles in the kitchen. I'd get empty jars every night. I had to milk cows and take care of chickens. And then back then, I probably started fifth grade. Anyway, I'd get on a tractor and drive until pretty late at night.
Wow.
I never did do any homework. We just didn't have time for it.
Uh-huh.
And in the morning, you know, time I'd do chores for 2 hours, feed cows.
Wow, that's a lot different than the kids nowadays.
Yeah, a little bit.
A lot.
There was only one time that I drove all the way to school, parked out with the teachers, and then they had Dad come get the pickup and take it back to the bus stop. It was a little late getting to the bus stop.
You drove the truck?
Yeah.
How old were you when you drove?
12, 14.
Oh my goodness, you were really young.
My first hay truck in when I was in 8th grade.
Oh,
driving
wow.
into town here and get a wave. That's all I guess I knew better, but it was just something you did.
These three people, Donna Herman, worked at the school?
Mm-hmm. Worked in this classroom room, I think.
What is it like working in the same classroom that you went to kindergarten in?
Well, it's changed a lot. So I don't think that much anymore when I first started. It was kind of neat.
Montague was probably more of a stronger community, knitted, interlocking with people. It wasn't just because maybe a second generation here. I mean, we just moved here when I was a year old. You guys moved here. Our folks didn't go to school here in Montague, but you become part of the community. And when we end up going to high school, you're proud to say you was from Montague. You know, just kind of a base you used to get. Like you're talking about the kids that are transient today. There's no values, no pride of being from anywhere. They're just kids running the streets. And it's different now than it was then, that everybody worked together. All of our parents knew each other. We all had different walks of life, but they all knew each other. And as much as you say you hate to agree with Hillary Clinton, her thing, it takes a village. That's the way it was here. When I'd come to town, you know, I didn't have to worry about my mom and dad knowing because there was 28 other parents that were keeping an eye on me.
Well, that was the way it was with all of us.
Yeah, that, I mean...
You know, you didn't want to do anything because you knew somebody was going to see
yeah.
you.
Yeah.
Yeah, and...
Your parents are going to find out.
Yeah, and they all got along, or pretty much got along. I mean, one kid or two weren't going to go and cause troubles for all of them.
Well, what do you think changed it?
I don't know. It's, you know, like John Vandy Hogan's fundraiser. The old people are still here. They're still the people that are proud of Montague, but it's not instilled in the kids. And they just seem to go downtown and break something is not.
If you could pass on anything to the kids that are graduating, what would you tell them? One important thing.
You can never go back.
What do you
mean?
That's
one thing. I mean, you gotta just remember that what goes around comes around, and you can't get back things that you do.
Mm-hmm.
Things that you don't do. You don't get another chance to do that. Like, I come back a lot in school, and I wish I'd been more forward and did more stuff.
That's interesting. And Rex, one thing you could tell them.
I tell a lot of them, take all the math and business you can, because you use it every day. I'm growing up here, you know, like playing sports. I don't know if I excelled or if I was just bigger. When I left, I mean, they have some big boys here now, but I was, I graduated, I was 5'10", weighed 220. Ooh. And I don't know, I was pretty big, but I packed it pretty well for a big boy. I don't know, there's a lot in the world besides sports, a lot of places to go when you get out of Montague. But if you look at our class, we figure six of us are dead. There's 10 of us that still live here. Mm-hmm. There's only a handful that aren't here or aren't coming back regularly. I guess it's not that bad a place to say you're from.
Very good.
Thank you for joining us here today.
Our final video guest is Montague resident Angie Farmer. Angie grew up in Montague and attended Montague Elementary School. Just like Donna Hammond, Angie also works here too. Hi Angie, I'm glad you could be here today. So, what years did you attend Montague Elementary School?
Well, 8th grade.
Pretty interesting. As far as the building goes, what's changed?
Well, there's been a lot of changes in the building. For one thing, the color's all different. It's been painted probably a couple times since I graduated. The awnings out here, they weren't here. The whole front of the building was pretty much a flush surface. The bus building was here. Remember that thing from there? The gym, the auditorium was out here, where they play the basketball gym, basketball games. Mrs. Weddle has her room in there. Ms. Akers has her class in there, too. That wasn't there. Now that was the 6th, 7th, and 8th grade buildings. Those were all much later additions. That was all an intramural baseball and football field. And if you want to come inside, we'll take a look. This was kind of a bit different. The second trophy case there. When I was in school, it was on the wall there. And as you can see, we've accumulated quite a few more trophies for store, needing the extra storage space. The office was a lot different. This was a solid wall, and it was just the first and second rooms. The third room was something else we'll cover down the hall. This was where we played our basketball games. And now it serves pretty much as just the lunchroom. And it comes through here. The basketball thing came through here. It was all painted. There was about this much standing room only for the basketball games. We didn't have a whole lot of spectators. Right here,
This was a faculty room. It was really long and narrow. It also served for extra storage for all the books, the textbooks we used. It had at that time, our copier was a mimeographing copier. So we had to make the mimeograph stencils out of carbon, and it was really messy with the ink. Sometimes it would run out of ink, but everybody always felt really privileged to be, you know, selected to do the one to do the mimeograph. Fifth grade, the rooms have changed pretty, the rooms has changed pretty much all equally, with one or two exceptions. This was a fifth grade room. We did not have carpeting at that time. You want to come inside? We didn't have any carpeting. The ceiling, the entire ceiling was dropped a little bit. It was drop lighting, fluorescent lighting. There was no blinds. We had a real heavy drape. That way when we showed films, obviously at that time there was no TV and VCR. That must be the old screen, probably still up there. And they showed us films, educational films or whatever. That's how we watched them. The rest of it looks pretty much the same. These walls are the same. Very little has changed in them, with the exception of the carpet and the blinds, replacing the drapes. If you'd like to look at the computer room, though, it's changed a great deal. Here we have, this is like another world. This is not even remotely close to what it looked like before. The whiteboard here, there was blackboards all around. There was the heavy drape, there was no fans. Obviously, there was no computers. These are all new. The decor is just completely different. It's a really nice addition, though.
It's a great room.
Yes, it was. Yeah. Matter of fact, there was kind of a, now it's funny. It wasn't funny at the time, but there was an incident here. I told you about the dropped lighting. It was solid solid thin plastic panels with the fluorescent bulbs ahead above them. And we had very big classes. We had about 30 or 32 kids in the class at the time. And there was one or two of the kids that were really quiet. And one specifically, he didn't have a lot of friends. He was really quiet. And he kind of was like a non-person in the class a lot of the time. It seemed like he didn't take much interest. And the teacher left the room one day to go do something, take a phone call, whatever it was. And the whole class, they were pretty rowdy kids. But this one day, this kid, I don't know what came over, and he got up and he came to the teacher's desk and he started picking up paper clips and rubber bands. He started shooting the lights full. Well, everybody just was so surprised. Nobody did much except laugh. You know, we were so surprised that he actually had it in him. And right about the time, we always had a lookout. So when the lookout let us know the teacher was back on their way back down, everybody, of course, sat back down and quieted up. And when the teacher came in and, you know, she saw some of the kids looking up, she noticed what had happened with the lights, and she was just furious. She was furious. And when she asked who was responsible, the kid didn't own up to it. He didn't deny it. He didn't own up to it. But when everybody told her who was responsible, she refused. She knew better. She knew this child was not capable of it. So we all sort of ended up getting punished. Of course, he did too in the long run. That was another matter altogether. Really lucky with this year. This is another change, big change for us. We had a real narrow little one length of a room shelf of a library when I was here. But this is all new. This has been completed just in the last couple of months. It's a state-of-the-art library. Computer system, filing system. We are acquiring books all along, every week or so. And our librarian, Bev Cross, she's wonderful. She's great as a storyteller. The kids love it. It's burned down this. At that time, this was not a hallway. This was the end of the building right here. We went out these double doors. And right here was the windiest breezeway you ever walked through. It had these big concrete green columns. There was probably 5 or 6 of them on each side. The wind would whistle right through here all the time. And we walked from here. So this is on the side, garden area, and the the Forest Service has provided us with a greenhouse, and as you can see, they're still working on that. Staff room, faculty room, teacher's room now. That's where the copying and all the teacher's lunches are taken and everything. That was a nice addition too. Okay, now this was the beginning of the primary building. So this is where the breezeway stopped and the actual building started. Of course, Mrs. Rogers wasn't here then. My kindergarten teacher, Marilyn Gibbons, was here at the time. We had our little, oh, they're gone, our little coat racks. Our little hooks for our tiny little coats and lunches. Okay, now, let's see. First and second grades were here, and right at that exit sign, the building ended. From there on, the double doors were up here, and from there on out, it was playground all the way. Now there is a trailer, a modular, that is used as a detention trailer for misbehavior or whatever. So they, and pretty much all the playground equipment is moved from here to this side and out here. These doors. Rather than looking out the windows and the doors and seeing all this, the blacktop here, it was gravel pretty much from the sidewalk here up to those first yellow basketball poles with bowls on them. There was a piece of blacktop from the trash receptacle there to this white line that goes across this way. All the rest of it was pretty much like loose gravel. And I remember many a skin knees out here, many a skin knees. There was a backstop right there. We played Annie over, but the blacktop over here was used for the basketball. There was two basketball goals, one at this end, one far end. And then here was where we played our volleyball. We played a lot of the other schools around here, Hornbrook and Aetna and Grenada, Giselle, Fort Jones, whatnot. And the volleyball here and the football was up there where the new gym now sits. That was a really nice addition. And as I said, the building here wasn't in existence at that time either. That was all grass. All this playground equipment, in this direction is new. With the exception of the monkey bars, they are still here. They're in a new place, as are those swings. And there was a couple of slides. But as I said, those were down at the far end of the hall on the primary side. That side of the playground was strictly for primary grades, the ones in this hall. And the older kids, third through eighth grade, would all have access to over here. And they didn't cross those lines whatsoever.
Memory about the school.
Well, besides the little coat racks that are never used anymore, it's not really a memory, but a whole series of them. I met some people that I've remained close with my entire life here. A lot of the kids that I went to school with from kindergarten and I graduated with eighth grade, graduated again through high school, and now my daughter is graduating from high school with those people's children, their sons and daughters. And it's really a nice feeling of family rather than friendship. Those kids are more like family, just pretty much as we were.
What is your best memory?
My best memory. Probably my fifth grade teacher had a lot to do with it. My best memory was in fifth grade. I think I enjoyed it. It was his first year. His name was Mr. Dusenberry, and he died a couple of years ago. But he was the greatest teacher. He was so nice. And not to mention that I did manage to get straight A's that year. That was probably the only year. But he was a real favorite, and he's very much missed. But he just made the whole year very special.
Memory.
Well, probably my eighth grade graduation. Not that it was, not the memory of the graduation itself was bad, but you have to remember that this is a very small community. And when I was graduating eighth grade, the shopping was really limited. Everybody went to Medford to shop for their dresses. It was a really big deal. Everybody had their hair done up. And we didn't have the gowns. Eighth graders now wear the long gowns just the same as the high school does. But we wore nice dresses, and there was about 9 or 10 girls is all in our eighth grade class, and four of us had the same exact dress, same color, probably the same length. That we were, two of us sat next to each other. That was pretty embarrassing.
We've talked about building changes, but have there been other changes, like in the teachers or students?
Well, the teachers have, I think Mrs. Weddle, she's still here. She seems to be a permanent fixture. And I believe she's probably the only one that's left. All the other teachers have changed. There's been several coming and going. Let's see, the school is a lot bigger and there's a lot more students here now. There was not split classes, and now there's a need for, you know, there's some of the grades have much more amount of students than what one classroom can accommodate, so they have several splits also. Activities that we did when I was here and I was involved in still remain. Matter of fact, there's an 8th grade girls fashion show in tea. It's not just 8th grade girls. I need to change that. There's boys included also. A lot of the merchants in Yreka provide the clothing and everything. And the very person that's responsible for this is Neva Weddle. And she is wonderful. The kids have loved her for so many years, and they still do. And this year when she retires, she's going to be very sorely missed. She's been such an asset, and she is the most loving person, and just she's wonderful. As far as the students, yes, there's been a lot of changes in the kids that are here, too. There's, due to a lot of outside circumstances, you know, home and community and whatnot, it seems that behavior has really changed. Before there was no detention trailer, there was no sort of detention program, community service program going on here at the school. I'm not sure if that was not because there was no need for it, but now those both have been instituted. There's a whole lot of changes. We have some very strong academically endowed children here. A lot of the kids go on and they do so very well in school, you know, due largely in part to what the education they received here from the teaching staff.
Feel about working at the same school where you were once a student?
It's really interesting. It's kind of like deja vu. I really never began. When it started out, I wasn't coming here to work. I came in, this is my son Dallas, and I came in just on a volunteer basis. When he was in second grade, I came in 2 or 3 days a week, you know, just at my leisure. It was really nice because I didn't have to keep any certain hours. And then very soon, within a few months, there was a couple of positions for a teacher's aide that became available through funding that they had gotten. And so this teacher just kind of commented that if I was going to be here, maybe I could just go ahead and might as well get paid for it.
Well, Dallas, what grade are you in?
Third.
How do you feel about your mom working here?
I feel like special, and whenever I forget something, then she can just go home and get it. And whenever I forget my snack, I can just call her and tell her to bring it with her.
When you grow up, if you have kids, do you think they'll go to this school?
Yeah, because I think it'll be like a family tradition.
Yeah, that's right. Your dad graduated from here. Mom, and your older sister, probably your older brother.
Well, thanks for being here and showing us around.
It's my pleasure.
You too, huh?
Thank you.
DJ, pick up.
Oh, I was dreaming that I went back in time and I saw the old schools. Wow, they were sure different. I even dreamed that I talked with some of the kids about what it was like back then.
Well,
you know, Miss Chastity, if that was history, it wasn't so bad.
Well, okay, DJ. Class dismissed.